The Good Dinosaur, Storybook Deluxe. In a world where dinosaurs never went extinct, it was a very special day. Three baby apatosauruses were born on a farm at the foot of Clawtooth Mountain. Libby hatched first, then Buck, and finally little Arlo, who was afraid to leave the safety of his egg. As they grew up, Libby and Buck worked hard and earned their marks on the family silo. Arlo longed to earn his mark too, but his fears kept getting in the way. One night, Papa took Arlo into a dark field. Papa didn't want Arlo's fear to keep him from seeing the beauty in the world. So Papa swiped his tail in the grass, and something amazing happened. Go ahead, touch the grass.
Sometimes you gotta get through your fear to see the beauty on the other side.
The next day, Papa asked Arlo to take care of the critter who'd been eating their corn. Arlo was determined to earn his mark, so he worked hard to set a trap for the critter.
First, you gotta add rocks to the net. Good. Now hitch it up in that tree. That's it. Now pull the trap up onto that branch. You're doing fine. Just keep going. All right. It's time to add the bait. You're doing fine. Just keep going. We're almost done. Just gotta hang the rattle so we'll hear that critter when it comes. Can't leave a job half done. Get that rattle hung up there. Good work. When that critter's taken care of, you'll put your mark on the silo right next to mine.
The trap worked, and the critter was caught. Arlo tried to be brave, but he didn't want to hurt the critter. Arlo hesitated, and the critter got away. Papa was upset. He and Arlo went searching for the critter as the sky darkened with rain. The river began to rise, and the ground rumbled. Suddenly, they saw a flash flood approaching. Papa had just enough time to get Arlo to safety before the flood swept him away. Papa was gone, and the family had to work even harder without him. Arlo looked sadly at Papa's footprint as he filled the silo with corn. Help Arlo fill the silo with corn. Make sure to fling the corn at the correct angle. Good job! You did it! Suddenly, Arlo heard crunching. The critter was back, and it was inside the silo.
Arlo chased the critter,
and they both fell into the river. Arlo gasped as the river pulled him under. Arlo washed up on an unfamiliar shore. He called out for Mama, and then he heard a howl from above. It was the critter. Arlo was furious. He thought this was all the critter's fault. Arlo struggled up the cliff. Arlo reached the top, but he had no idea how to get home. Then he saw the river and remembered Papa's words.
As long as you can find the river, you can find your way home.
Arlo followed the river. But he was hungry. He spotted berries in a tree and tried to reach them. Then he slipped and got stuck under a rock. After a long and scary night, Arlo awoke to find he'd been freed. But how? It began raining, and Arlo knew he had to build a shelter. And that wouldn't be easy. Help Arlo build a shelter from the rain. Nicely done. That's it. Use all the sticks you can find to build the shelter. Nicely done. Use all the sticks you can find to build the shelter. Use all the sticks you can find to build. You should be proud. The critter appeared again. It could see that Arlo was hungry and offered him some food. Try giving these items to Arlo. Try giving these items to Arlo. Try giving these items to Arlo. They went to find more food. Arlo was still angry with the critter. But then it protected Arlo from a scary, snake-like creature. Arlo started to wonder if the critter wasn't so bad after all. Then Arlo heard a strange voice. It was a Styracosaurus who collected creatures with fearsome names. He challenged Arlo to a contest. Whoever named the critter would keep him. Arlo cried out the name Spot, and the critter took to it. Arlo had won. The Styracosaurus could see that Arlo and Spot shared a bond. He told Arlo that Spot would keep him safe.
This is Dream, and this is Debbie. This is Fury. He protects me from the creatures that crawl in the night.
Now, Arlo and Spot were working together. They even found time to have some fun. Try to get as many gophers as you can. Nicely done. Nicely done. Good job. Good job. Nicely done. Good job. That's it. Nicely done. That was some fine work. That night, Arlo grew sad. He missed Papa. Arlo drew a circle around five sticks, a portrait of his family. Spot understood. He circled three sticks, then covered two with dirt. Arlo covered Papa's stick with dirt. He and Spot looked up at the stars and howled together. The morning brought a huge storm. Arlo was terrified, and he ran for cover, losing sight of the river. After the storm, Arlo was completely lost. He asked some passing pterodactyls for directions, but the leader, Thunderclap, tried to steal Spot. help Arlo dodge the pterodactyls. Good job! Uh-oh! That's it! Just as the pterodactyls caught up to Arlo, some fearsome Tyrannosaurus Rexes appeared. The T-Rexes roared and chased the pterodactyls away. Nash, Ramsay, and their father Butch turned out to be friendly ranchers who had lost their herd of longhorns. The T-Rexes agreed to help Arlo find his way home, if Spot could sniff out their missing longhorns. Spot tracked down the gang of rustlers who had stolen the herd. Arlo was afraid to get the rustlers' attention, so Spot helped. The rustlers appeared, and then the T-Rexes sprang their trap on the thieving raptors. Arlo was scared, but he helped chase the raptors away. That night, the T-Rexes swapped scar stories around the fire. Butch's fight with a giant croc had left him with a mean scar and one of the croc's teeth. Butch admitted to Arlo that he had been scared during the fight, but he pushed through his fear.
Listen, kid, you can't get rid of fear, but you can get through it. You can find out what you're made of.
The next morning, Arlo and Spot helped the T-Rexes herd the longhorns. Help Arlo make his way to the front of the herd. Jump over anything that comes along. Great herding. Soon, Clawtooth Mountain appeared in the distance. Arlo knew the way home. He and Spot said goodbye to the T-Rexes. Home was almost in sight. Arlo and Spot were overjoyed. They howled in excitement. Then, someone returned their howls. Arlo was worried that Spot seemed interested in the stranger. So Arlo picked him up and headed for home. Suddenly, some familiar shapes appeared. The pterodactyls! and they wanted Spot. Help Arlo dodge the pterodactyls. Some fine work. As hard as he tried, Arlo couldn't fight off the pterodactyls forever. They snatched Spot and flew into the storm. Arlo chased after them, but he fell and hit his head. When Arlo looked up, Arlo was thrilled until he realized that Papa wasn't leaving footprints. Papa wasn't really there. Arlo knew he had to head into the storm, even though it was dangerous, because of his love for Spot. And Arlo knew that Papa would be proud of him.
I knew you had it in you. You're me and more. I knew you had it in you. You're me and more.
As the storm got worse, Arlo tracked down Spot and confronted the pterodactyls. There was a nasty struggle, but Arlo managed to knock most of them into the river. Then he let out a mighty roar, scaring Thunderclap away. The river began to rise, and the ground rumbled. Arlo trembled in fear. He knew a flood was coming, but his love for Spot steadied his nerves. Arlo leaped to shield Spot from the oncoming flood. Help Arlo rescue Spot as fast as you can. Save Spot before they reach the waterfall. You should be proud. Arlo caught up to Spot just in time to protect him as they went over a huge waterfall. Soon they reached the shore. Arlo was relieved when Spot opened his eyes. They were both okay. They were almost home when a familiar howl sounded. The stranger had returned with his whole family. Arlo knew what he had to do. It wasn't easy. but Arlo said goodbye to Spot. Arlo finally reached the farm. He was back home, and his family was overjoyed to see him. He pressed his foot to the silo. Arlo had taken care of the critter and earned his mark. He pressed his foot to the silo. He pressed his foot to the silo. Arlo had He pressed his foot. Disney Pixar, the good. Go ahead and pick a game.
Cars, Mater's Junkyard Jamboree. Adapted by Nancy Casolaro and Catherine Wood. Illustrated by Scott Tilley, Andrew Phillipson, and the Disney Storybook Artists. Yeehaw! Mater the tow truck hollered. My junkyard jukebox is almost done. Mater had been building the jukebox all week. He just needed one last tire. Shoot. Looks like my favorite tire has plumb disappeared, he said. Well, I suppose I can add it later, Mater said. Then he hooked up his jukebox to his tow line and went to show Ramon. But some little tractors were on the loose, and Ramon was busy trying to catch them. I can help, Mater offered. I'll just put away this here jukebox first. Mater ran into Lightning McQueen on the way home. Hey, I built something you're going to, he started. Lightning interrupted. Later, Mater, I've got to round up these little tractors. He zoomed off. Mater also stopped at Casa della Tires. Luigi didn't have time to hear his junkyard jukebox either. No, 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 Luigi cried. Look at Luigi's leaning tower of tires. Now she is just Luigi's pile of tires. In front of the fire station, Red was sobbing over his flowers. They were ruined. Did the little tractors do this too? Asked Mater. Mater was almost back to his junkyard when he bumped into Sheriff. Hey, Sheriff, you'll never guess what I made. Mater, I've got no time for lollygagging. Sheriff turned on his siren and went to round up the tractors. Sure enough, the little tractors were everywhere. Pfft! Move! Whirr! Radiator Springs was a mess. For such cute little fellas, these tractors sure are causing a load of trouble, Mater exclaimed. I really have to put away my jukebox so I can help my friends. As Mater hurried back to his junkyard, he cranked up the jukebox and began to sing along with the music. A tractor followed him shyly. Soon, some other little tractors started following Mater and his jukebox, too. Before long, Mater realized what was happening. The tractors wanted to listen to the music. Mater turned his jukebox up louder. "Well, looky here," Mater cried as he rounded up the tractors. "These little fellas like my music." He towed his jukebox back into the junkyard and the tractors danced right in after it. Mater's friends saw what had happened. "Mater corralled the tractors," cried Sally. Everyone cheered. "Hip hip hooray for Mater!" "That's music to my ears," Sheriff sighed with relief. Now that the tractors weren't getting into trouble, everyone was able to enjoy Mater's jukebox music. "These little tractors sure do make a tow truck smile," Mater declared. Mater's jukebox had saved the day, and now, every time Mater cranks it up, the little tractors return for another junkyard jamboree.
Riley Anderson was a lively 11-year-old with a lot going on in her head. In fact, there was a whole world on the inside, controlled by 5 emotions. Joy, the lead emotion, helped Riley make the best out of every day. Anger, fear, and disgust also used their unique talents to keep Riley safe and sound. But the 5th emotion, sadness. Joy didn't understand why sadness was there.
You think it's safe?
Great. This is just great.
Okay, caution. There is a dangerous smell, people.
That's sad.
Another perfect day.
With Joy at the controls, most of Riley's memories were happy, stored in joyous yellow spheres. Sometimes another emotion would take control for a memory of anger, disgust, or fear. But Joy kept sadness away from the controls so that Riley wouldn't have too many blue memories.
But the really important ones are over here. I don't want to get too technical, but these are called core memories. Each one came from a super important time in Riley's life.
Then Riley's family moved to San Francisco, and things changed. Riley was in a strange new town, had no friends, and her dad was gone all the time. Even the pizza was gross. Still, Joy was determined to make the best of things, as always.
Riley can't live here.
I'm telling you, it smells like something died in here.
Congratulations, San Francisco! You've ruined pizza!
Oh, Mom and Dad are stressed out!
Who puts broccoli on pizza?
The first day of school did not go well. Sadness took control, and Riley cried in front of her new class. It was a tragic moment that created something the emotions had never seen before, a blue core memory sphere.
Everything's different now.
since we moved.
Oh no, we're crying at school!
Joy wanted Riley to forget the memory, so she tried to throw it away. But sadness wanted to keep it. In the struggle, a vacuum tube sucked up all of Riley's core memory spheres, along with joy and sadness themselves. Joy and sadness had disappeared, so fear, anger, and disgust tried their best to guide Riley through the day. But dinner was a disaster. Without Joy in charge, Riley couldn't find anything to be happy about. Joy found herself a long way from headquarters. She had to get Riley's core memories back, and fast. But she needed Sadness's help to get there, or they might fall into the memory dump, where they would be forgotten forever. Joy and Sadness met Bing Bong, Riley's imaginary friend from childhood who was made of cotton candy. Bing Bong hadn't played with Riley in years. He just wanted Riley to remember him. Bing Bong knew a shortcut to headquarters, so Joy asked Bing Bong to join them. Meanwhile, Riley was having more trouble. She had stopped talking to her old friends. She wasn't making any new ones, and she got too angry to pass hockey tryouts. Riley needed Joy back in control, and fast.
That's it!
No, breathe, find your happy place. Ah!
In Imagination Land, Bing Bong recovered his beloved wagon rocket. Just in time to see it get thrown in the memory dump, Bing Bong was heartbroken. Joy tried every funny trick she knew, but she couldn't cheer up Bing Bong. Instead, Sadness sat with Bing Bong and offered her support. Bing Bong cried candy tears. Soon, Bing Bong felt better and led them to the shortcut. Joy was surprised that Sadness was able to help Bing Bong feel better. Riley's train of thought couldn't run while she was asleep, so Joy and Sadness needed to wake her up. They snuck into Dream Productions to change Riley's dream. Joy thought she could wake up Riley by making her really happy. But Sadness thought they needed to scare Riley to wake her up. Sure enough, when Jangles the Clown stormed onto the set, he terrified Riley, and Riley woke up. Sadness was right after all. Aboard the train of thought, Joy told Sadness about her favorite day, when Riley sat in the twisty tree with her parents and her hockey team. That was also Sadness's favorite day, because of how sad Riley had been when she missed the game-winning goal. Joy didn't understand why Sadness couldn't be less sad. At headquarters, Anger was tired of all the troubles Riley was having. He put an idea into Riley's mind. Riley should run away from home and go back to Minnesota, where she had been happy. Riley accepted Anger's idea to run away. This caused chaos within her mind, and things outside of headquarters began to fall apart. Joy and Bing Bong fell into the memory dump. Joy felt overwhelming sadness. If she couldn't get out of the memory dump, she would fade away and be forgotten forever. She watched her favorite memory again and realized that Riley's happiness that day wouldn't have been possible if Riley hadn't been so sad at first. Joy realized that Riley really needed Sadness after all. Joy and Bing Bong found Bing Bong's wagon rocket. The louder they sang, the higher the wagon flew. But the wagon was just too heavy to fly out of the dump. Bing Bong jumped off of the wagon to make it lighter, and Joy made it out of the memory dump. Bing Bong waved goodbye to Joy as he faded away. "Take her to the moon for me," he said. Riley arrived at the bus station. Her bus was about to leave for Minnesota. Anger, fear, and disgust were having second thoughts about the plan. But it was too late to change Riley's mind. The controls didn't work anymore. They couldn't get Riley to feel anything. Joy used quick thinking and a big trampoline to grab Sadness and reach headquarters. All five emotions were finally back together. But how could they convince Riley to change her mind? Joy did something she had never done before. She handed the controls over to Sadness. With sadness at the controls, Riley felt sad for the first time in days. She realized she had made a mistake, and she got off the bus. Joy gave sadness all of Riley's core memory spheres, including the blue one. The golden memories turned blue as sadness touched them. Riley cried as she admitted to her parents that she missed Minnesota. Riley's parents understood. It was okay to be sad. They missed Minnesota too. They would get through the tough times together. Joy had learned that sadness was just as important as all the other emotions. Soon, Riley joined the hockey team and made new friends. She was enjoying life again, now that all five emotions were working together as a team.
You ready?
Yeah.
All right.
Let's play some hockey! All right, Anger, take
it! Give us that puck for your dead feet!
On our left! On our left!
Let's just try not to get all smelly this time.
Oh, Mom and Dad are watching us fail.
Not for long!
Walt Disney's Dumbo. It was morning at the circus. Hopeful mothers looked up as storks flew overhead. Each one carried a bundle holding a baby animal. Mrs. Jumbo sighed as she watched the happy mothers with their babies. Oh dear, I did so hope there would be a bundle for me, she thought. At long last, a stork flew into Mrs. Jumbo's railway car with a large bundle. It was a baby elephant. The other elephants began to giggle. Dumbo, one of them said. But Mrs. Jumbo didn't care what the other elephants thought. She loved her baby, big ears and all. The next day, a group of boys came by the circus tent. They laughed at Dumbo and teased him. Look at his ears, one of them cried. Mrs. Jumbo tried to protect her baby. She lifted the boy away from Dumbo. Help! Help! He wailed. The circus keepers raced in. Soon, Mrs. Jumbo was locked in the prison wagon. From then on, the other elephants ignored poor Dumbo. They even turned their backs on him. Dumbo felt alone and heartbroken until Timothy Mouse found him. He liked Dumbo. At last, Dumbo had a friend. Timothy wanted to help his new friend. All we've got to do is build you an act, the mouse explained. Make you a star. He wanted Dumbo to be the very top elephant on the pyramid, the star. Finally, the big moment came. But when Dumbo ran down the springboard, he tripped over his flapping ears. He crashed into the elephants, knocking them in every direction. Now the elephants were angrier than ever with Dumbo. But the ringmaster had one more idea. The next day, Dumbo was put in the clown act. Being a clown made Dumbo sad. The other clowns teased him, and Dumbo felt lonelier than ever. "We'll go and see your mother," said Timothy to cheer up Dumbo. Dumbo and his mother were overjoyed to see each other. Mrs. Jumbo put her trunk through the bars of her cage and cuddled her son, singing a lullaby. But all too soon, it was time for Dumbo to go. That night, Dumbo dreamed he was a star, flying through the air. The next thing Dumbo and Timothy knew, it was morning. When they opened their eyes, they saw a group of crows looking at them. They were high up in a tree. Timothy and Dumbo wondered how they had gotten there. "Maybe you flew up," joked one of the crows. "Yes, that's it," cried Timothy. "Dumbo, you flew! Your ears, they're perfect wings." The little elephant was surprised. He couldn't really fly, could he? Timothy told Dumbo to believe in himself. One of the crows gave Timothy an ordinary feather and whispered, "Use the magic feather." Holding the feather in his trunk, Dumbo soared from the edge of a cliff. He was flying. That night at the circus, Dumbo stood at the top of a building. He didn't feel frightened. Now that he had the magic feather, he knew he could fly down safely. Dumbo took a deep breath and began to flap his ears as quickly as he could. Suddenly, Dumbo was flying. He didn't need that feather after all. The ringmaster was amazed. He watched Dumbo swoop from the building and soar past the cheering crowds. Dumbo was a star. Before long, Dumbo was famous all around the world, just as Timothy said he would be. Crowds flocked to the circus to see Dumbo, the amazing flying elephant. The ringmaster released Dumbo's mother and gave her a special train car of her own. And Dumbo and his mother were very happy. The end. Walt Disney's Dumbo.
Monsters University, Scaring Lessons by Susan Americaner, illustrated by Fabio Laguna, Lori Tominski, Adrian Brown, Jeff Jenny, Frank Anduiza, and the Disney Storybook Artists. Monsters University is a school for monsters. In the scaring program, students learn to scare humans. The students must be very scary. Mike is a student. Sully is a student too. He looks scary. He does not study. Mike does not look scary. He studies. Mike and Sully do not like each other. At the final scare test, Mike roars at Sully. Sully roars at Mike. Sully breaks the dean's scream can. She kicks them out of the scaring program. Mike and Sully join the Oozma Kappas. They enter the scare games as a team. The winners will get into the scaring program. The Oozma Kappa team wants to win. The first event is a race. The teams run into a dark tunnel. Sully runs ahead. Mike runs to catch up. Their team is left behind. Mike trains the Oozma Kappas. They work together. One event is a hiding game. Don hides. Oozma Kappa does well. The last event is a scaring game. The team must scare a robot. The team that gets the loudest screams wins. Mike goes last. He scares his robot. His robot screams the loudest. The Oozma Kappas win. The team cheers. They lift Mike up in the air. He is a hero. Mike checks the robot. Sully made the robot scream. Sully cheated. He did not think Mike was scary enough. Mike will scare a human. He wants to prove he is scary. Mike goes to the human world. He finds a cabin. It is full of kids. They are not scared of Mike. Mike is scared of them. Sully finds Mike. They need a big scream to get home. Sully is scary. Mike is smart. They need each other. Sully and Mike work together. Mike coaches Sully. Sully roars. They scare the humans. The humans scream. The screams are loud. The door opens. Sully and Mike go home. The dean is proud. She wishes them good luck. Mike and Sully find jobs at Monsters, Inc.
Sophia the First, the Floating Palace. What would you like to do first? I could tell you about the Floating Palace. We could create... I'm Sophia, and I love being a princess. For our summer vacation, my family is visiting Marraway Cove on our boat. It's so big, it's more like a floating palace. Lately, I've been reading about mermaids. Maybe we'll see one at the cove. I hope so. But Dad says mermaids aren't real. My dad, King Roland, is usually right about most things, but he's wrong about mermaids. Because when I go to the deck of our floating palace, there she is! A real, live mermaid!
Help!
Oh, no! She's tangled in a net! Let me help you, I say. I pull her onto the boat and untangle her.
Thank you.
She says, her name is Una. She's really nice. But then she says she has to go.
We're not supposed to spend time above the water.
She explains, but when Una gets in the water, she can't swim. Her fin is hurt. As I slide into the sea to help her, my amulet glows, and I turn into a mermaid. I can't believe it, and neither can Una.
How did you do that?
Una asks. I tell her about my magical amulet. Una has a comb that's enchanted too.
I'm not sure what its powers are,
says Una.
But Mom says she'll tell me when I'm older.
I help Una swim toward her home in the cove. We swim past a kelp forest, a cool sunken ship, and hundreds of beautiful fish. When we get near Una's home, I meet her friend, Sven the Seahorse, and her big sister, Cora. They use moon kelp to heal Una's tail. Suddenly, the water goes dark. It's our floating palace stopping above us. Then, we hear Una's mom calling her and Cora home. Una's mom is the Mermaid Queen.
I'm so glad you're safe,
she exclaims.
A human vessel is in the cove, and humans are dangerous.
But I'm not dangerous, and neither is my family. Queen Emmeline doesn't know that, though. And she wants to use her magic trident to create a powerful storm, one that could blow the floating palace out of the cove, or maybe even sink it. My family is on that ship. So I tell the queen that I'm a human, and I can get the ship to leave. Please don't sink it. Just give me a chance, I say. Luckily, the queen agrees to let me try. Una and Cora wish me luck. I start swimming back to the floating palace. Suddenly, I hear Una calling my name. Oh no! A horrible, hideous sea monster is chasing her. He wants her enchanted comb. I swim after them as fast as I can, but then they enter the kelp forest. Una! I cry. There's no answer. I rush back to tell Queen Emmeline what happened, and she tells me I have till sundown to rescue Una. The queen says if I can't, she'll sink the floating palace. I swim back to the ship. I need help, but my family doesn't believe in mermaids. So I gather some friends who do believe. Sven, Clover, and a seagull named Barley. Finally, we find Una. The sea monster has her trapped, and he's about to steal her enchanted comb. I try to stop him, but he's very powerful. He almost captures me, too. Oh no! Queen Emmeline is starting loud thunder over the cove! I need to rescue Una before her mom sinks my family's ship! I don't know what to do.
Your necklace is glowing?
Sven tells me. When we dive underwater, Princess Ariel appears. My amulet brought her to help. So I tell Ariel about Una. I tried to save her, but...
You need more help,
Ariel says. She tells me that humans and mermaids both love their families, and if we just work together... Now I know what to do! Sven and I find Cora and tell her about the sea monster. He's after Una's comb, I explain. The only way to save her is for us to work together. So Cora and I come up with a plan. Sven, Barley, and Clover help too. I have to sneak onto the boat where the sea monster has Una trapped. I get there just as he is about to cast a spell to grab Una's comb, but I snatch it right out of his hand.
Give me the comb, and I'll let your mermaid friend go,
the sea monster says. What if I don't, I say.
Then I'll cast a spell on you and make you disappear.
I step in front of Una's cage. Then I toss the comb overboard where Cora is waiting to catch it.
No, you don't!
The sea monster howls. He flicks his wand at me, but I jump out of the way. Instead of making me disappear, he makes Una's cage vanish. Una's free! But the sea monster is furious. He points his wand at us.
You won't trick me again!
He warns. Suddenly, Barley flies over the sea monster and drops Clover right on top of him. Then Farley swoops down and grabs the monster's wand. Korra holds up the comb as it starts to glow.
Waters, rise at my command!
She cries, then a spiral of water blasts the sea monster across the cove. We rush back to Queen Emmeline.
Thank goodness you're safe.
The queen cries. She raises her trident to stop the storm. Phew! Now my family is safe, too. Una's family and I go back to the floating palace. We can't wait for our two families to meet. Dad admits he never thought mermaids were real, but now he knows. I sit with Una and watch the sunset. She's a mermaid, and I'm a human, but I know we'll be friends forever. The end.
Toy Story 3, Toy Trouble, by Keel Murray. Pictures by John Paul Orpinas. Designed by Winnie Ho. Woody the Sheriff, Jessie the Cowgirl, and Buzz Lightyear, the Space Ranger, had always been a terrific team. They looked out for each other and for the rest of the toys in Andy's room. But things had changed. Andy had grown up and didn't have time to play with his toys anymore. Soon he would be leaving for college. What were the toys going to do? Woody wanted to stay at Andy's house. He knew that Andy would store the toys safely in the attic, but Jessie wasn't ready for the attic. She still wanted to play with kids. "What's important is that we stay together," said Buzz. When Jessie spotted a box of old toys in Andy's mom's car, she knew just what to do. The box was being donated to Sunnyside, the local daycare center. There'd be plenty of kids to play with there. Woody followed the other toys into the box. He tried to convince them to stay, but he was too late. Andy's mom got into her car and drove away. The toys were going to Sunnyside. When the toys arrived at the daycare center, a strawberry-scented bear named Lotso welcomed them with hugs. He introduced them to his friends and showed them the caterpillar room, where they would be staying. Sunnyside seemed perfect. The toys couldn't wait to play with all the kids. Jessie was sure that coming there had been the right choice. Woody didn't feel the same way. He told his friends he was going back to Andy, with or without them. The toys wanted to stay, so Woody left alone. The toys were sad to see Woody go, but as he walked out the door, the classroom bell rang. Playtime was about to start. Unfortunately, playtime at Sunnyside wasn't what the toys had expected. The caterpillar room was for little kids who played rough with their toys. One kid used Jessie's hair as a paintbrush. Another used Buzz's head as a hammer. Ouch! "Andy never played with us like that," cried Rex. The toys were upset. Why couldn't they be in the butterfly room with the older kids? "I'll go talk to Lotso about moving us to the other room," said Buzz. But the door was locked. They were trapped. Luckily, Buzz spotted a way out. He quickly climbed through an open window. Jessie and the other toys watched as he dropped into the hallway. The toys waited and waited, but Buzz didn't return. Jessie was starting to think that coming to Sunnyside hadn't been such a good idea after all. Soon, Lotso arrived. Jessie told him that she and her friends needed to go home. "Here's the thing," Lotso said. "You ain't leaving Sunnyside." "Oh yeah? Who's gonna stop us?" asked Jessie as she headed for the door. Suddenly, Jessie came face to face with Buzz, who blocked her path. "Buzz, you're back!" shouted Rex as he ran to greet his friend. But instead of hugging Rex, Buzz tackled him. Then Buzz knocked all of Andy's toys to the floor. "Prisoners disabled, Commander Lotso," said Buzz. Commander Lotso? What was going on? "Buzz, what are you doing?" Jesse cried. "Silence, minions of Zurg. You're in the custody of the Galactic Alliance," said Buzz. Lotso had done something to Buzz. He thought he was a real space ranger. Buzz locked the toys up in metal cubbies. It was a toy prison. Woody was gone, and now Buzz didn't recognize his friends. Jesse knew that she'd made a terrible mistake bringing her friends to Sunnyside. But the next day, Woody came back. He had realized that he'd made a mistake too. He shouldn't have left his friends. "From now on, we stick together," said Woody. The toys had to get Buzz back and get out of Sunnyside. Working together, the toys captured Buzz. They managed to reset him so that he was their friend again. Escaping from Sunnyside was going to be trickier, but Andy's toys made a great team. They sneaked past Lotso's security. All they had to do was make it through the trash chute and they'd be free. But when the toys slid down the trash chute, Lotso and his gang were waiting for them. The mean bear would never let them leave Sunnyside. He wanted to keep them there to play with the little kids in the caterpillar room. "Why don't you come back and join our family again?" Lotso said. "This isn't a family, it's a prison," cried Jesse. "I'd rather rot in this dumpster than join any family of yours." As Lotso's gang surrounded Andy's toys, Woody and Buzz stepped forward and stood by Jesse's side. No matter what happened, the toys would face it together. But Lotso's gang didn't grab Andy's toys. They turned against Lotso. The Sunnyside toys had realized that Jesse was right. Lotso had made the daycare a toy's worst nightmare. They weren't going to listen to him anymore. Suddenly, a garbage truck arrived. When it picked up the dumpster, Andy's toys fell into the truck. Now they had a new problem. They were headed for the city dump. At the dump, the toys were dropped onto a giant conveyor belt, headed right for a scary incinerator. This time, Andy's toys stuck together. They helped each other and made it out safe and sound. Then the toys sneaked onto another garbage truck and rode all the way to Andy's house. Back home, Woody, Jesse, and Buzz were as happy as ever. The toys didn't know yet what the future had in store for them, but they knew in their hearts that as long as they stuck together, everything would work out just fine.
Winnie the Pooh, Pooh's Secret Garden. Written by Katherine Hopka. Illustrated by the Disney storybook artists. One sunny spring morning, Winnie the Pooh woke up with a rumbly in his tumbly. "Oh, bother," he said. "I seem to be all out of honey." Now what is a hungry bear to do? Think, think, think. Pooh was a bear of very little brain. But with his tummy's help, he soon came up with an idea. He wandered through the 100-acre wood to a tidy house beside a tidy garden. Then he knocked on the tidy door, and Rabbit answered. He was just about to do some gardening. "Gardening looks like very hard work, Rabbit," Pooh said after a while. "Are you sure it's not time to stop for a small smackerel of honey?" "Quite sure, Pooh," Rabbit replied. "Would you mind handing me that watering can?" "Not at all, Rabbit," said Pooh. When he picked up the watering can, several buzzing bees flew out from underneath. "There are bees in your garden, Rabbit," Pooh exclaimed.
It wouldn't be much of a garden without 'em, Rabbit said. Plants need bees' help to turn their flowers into vegetables. I wouldn't know much about that, Pooh said. All I know is that where there are bees, there's sure to be honey, Pooh continued. He followed one of the bees, hoping to find some honey. All he found was the bee sipping nectar from a flower. Yes, Rabbit said. Bees need flowers to make honey. They do? Pooh squinted at the bees. Of course they do. It's no secret, Pooh. I see, Pooh said. If you'll excuse me, Rabbit, I have some very important thinking to do. He hurried out of Rabbit's garden and through the wood. Pooh was thinking so hard that he nearly walked straight into a cloud of dust. He waved his arms to clear the air and found Piglet. He was doing some spring cleaning. You're looking thoughtful today, Pooh, Piglet said. I've just learned that bees need gardens to make honey. Pooh leaned closer, and I heard it was a secret. So you're going to plant a secret garden? Piglet whispered. Pooh nodded. Shall we search for a secret spot to plant it? The two friends began searching for spots. But they found stripes instead. What are you two explorigating? Tigger asked. Pooh told Tigger about his secret garden. All we need is the perfect spot, he finished. Well, you found it, Tigger exclaimed. He bounced up. It's just right, Pooh said. Now I suppose I'd better... That is, it must be time to... Oh, bother. He scratched his head. What exactly is it that I'm supposed to do now? Piglet and Tigger had no more idea than Pooh did. So all three of them went in search of someone who was likely to know all there was to know about secret gardens. And most everything else, too. The friends went to see Owl. Do you know how to go about planting a secret garden, Owl? Pooh asked hopefully. Certainly, Owl said. My great aunt Eunice used to mention such matters quite frequently. In any case, I'm sure I have something here that will tell us exactly what to do. He led the way to his bookshelves and pulled out a large volume. Is that a book about secret gardens? Piglet asked. Precisely, Owl said. Let's have a look, shall we? Of course, this is a cookbook, not a book on gardening, said Owl with a ruffle of his feathers. What we need are seeds. Let's go borrow some from Old Long Ears, Tigger said. They all went to Rabbit's house. What do you need with seeds? Rabbit asked when he heard what they wanted. It's a secret, Pooh said. I suppose we could tell you if... Here, Rabbit said, just take the seeds. The friends returned to the site of Pooh's secret garden. Owl supervised while the others got started. Pooh didn't know much about planting seeds, but following Owl's instructions, he dug up a patch of dirt and dropped several seeds into the hole. Pooh and his friends were still planting seeds when Kanga happened by. Oh my, she said. You all seem to be working very hard. Let me bring you something to drink. She soon returned with a pitcher of lemonade. Thank you, Mrs. Kanga, Piglet said politely. The lemonade is delicious. It sure is, Tigger agreed. But what we really need is someone to help with all this diggification. Kanga smiled. Roo and I might be able to help with that too, she said. With help from Piglet, Tigger, Owl, Kanga, and Roo, Pooh soon had his secret garden planted. Now we need to wait for the plants to grow, Owl said. Pooh smiled. And then I'll have all the honey I can eat. He patted his tummy to tell it to be patient. And then they waited. And waited, and waited some more. Weeks passed. The plants grew like weeds, and bees started buzzing around the flowers.
but there was no sign of honey anywhere. Where could the honey be? Pooh wondered aloud. He lifted a leaf, searching for any sign of tasty golden honey, but found a tomato instead. It wasn't honey, but it still looked delicious. Your secret garden was a delicious idea, Pooh, Piglet said. Yes, it was, Pooh sighed. It would be even tastier if it would just grow some honey. Just then, Roo arrived with Rabbit. I told Rabbit about your garden, he said. Pooh nodded. That's fine, since Rabbit is the one who told me about the secret that makes gardens grow honey. If only I knew the secret of where bees hide it, Pooh added. Rabbit looked confused. There's no secret to that. All you have to do is follow the bees to their hive. Look, there goes a bee now, Roo exclaimed. They watched the bee until it flew into a stump. Pooh pulled back some loose bark and found honey. It seems the bees in Pooh's secret garden had a secret of their own. After that, the honey wasn't a secret anymore, and neither was the garden. Pooh's friends stayed busy picking tasty vegetables. The bees stayed buzzy, sipping nectar from the flowers. And Pooh stayed happy and rather sticky, collecting all the honey he could eat.
Dusty Crophopper had been a world-famous racing champion for 3 years. He pushed himself hard in race after race, and the fans loved him. Between races, he always returned home to Propwash Junction to spend time with his friends. Each day, Skipper, Dusty's coach, put the champ through his paces in a training run. Collect as many tokens as you can. One afternoon during training, Dusty's engine stuttered. He fell into a spin. Luckily, Dusty regained control, and Skipper guided him in for an emergency landing.
My engine!
Dottie, Dusty's mechanic, had bad news. His reduction gearbox was failing, and it couldn't be replaced. So Dottie fitted Dusty with a warning light. She told him that if the light came on, he'd have to slow down.
You're saying I can't race anymore?
That night, Dusty took off to test himself. As he started to go faster, his warning light began to flash. Distracted by the light, Dusty accidentally clipped a tower, landed hard, and skidded into the Fill and Fly gas station. The gas pump exploded. Tap on the leaks in Mayday's fire. Thank you. Earn the firefighter badge, tap on the leaks in Mayday's hose fast enough to get the fire under control. Mayday, the town's fire engine, tried to put out the blaze, but his fire hose was leaking. Dusty, Mayday, and their friends worked together to topple the water tower and put out the flames.
Pull!
The next day, safety officials shut down the airport. It couldn't reopen until Mayday hired a second firefighter. Mayday told Dusty about aerial firefighters. Instead of dusting crops like Dusty used to, they dropped water. That gave Dusty an idea.
Yeah, I got to witness one of the very first aerial firefighters.
The next day, Dusty flew to Piston Peak National Park, home to the Grand Fusel Lodge. Dusty went to meet Mayday's friend, Blade Ranger, a fire and rescue helicopter. He was going to train Dusty to be Propwash Junction's second firefighter. Soon after Dusty arrived at the base, an emergency horn blared. There was a wildfire to fight. Smoke jumpers rolled up a ramp into Cabby, their transport plane. Maru, a mechanic, pumped fire retardant into Dipper, a super scooter. Windlifter, a mighty heavy lift copter, thundered into the air. Blade was already on the scene when the team arrived. He, Windlifter, and Dipper dived and released fire retardant. Then, smoke jumpers parachuted out of Cabby to dig a fire line, which would keep the blaze from spreading. Clear a path through the forest.
Palace Pets. Snuggle Buddies. Adapted by Courtney Carbone. Based on text by Amy Sky Coster. Illustrated by the Disney Storybook Art Team. Pumpkin is a playful puppy. She cannot sit still. She likes to twirl. Pumpkin is a playful puppy. She cannot sit still. She likes to twirl and swirl. Berry is a shy bunny. She lives in the woods. She loves to eat ripe berries. They are so tasty. Beauty is a sleepy kitty. She likes long naps.
Shh, don't wake her up.
Blondie is a small pony with a big wish. She wants to be a royal horse. Will her dream come true? Pumpkin needs a home. The prince thinks she would love the palace. He thinks Cinderella would love Pumpkin. Berry is hungry. She wants some berries. Snow White has a whole bucket full of berries. Aurora finds Beauty asleep in her garden. Beauty wakes up. They share a smile. Aurora loves the pretty kitty. Blondie sneaks into the royal parade. It is so much fun. Rapunzel watches the show. Cinderella dances the night away. Pumpkin joins in. What a big surprise for Cinderella! She watches the dancing puppy. Snow White has baked a pie. It is blueberry, Berry's favorite. Berry comes out from her hiding place. She was in the bucket of berries. Aurora has three fairy friends. They will help take care of Beauty. Aurora brings Beauty to the palace. Rapunzel spots Blondie. She knows the pony is special. The crowd cheers. Cinderella and Pumpkin dance together. Berry is the perfect pet for Snow White. Aurora hugs her sweet kitty. Rapunzel makes Blondie a royal horse. The princesses have found snuggly palace pets.
Toy Story, Starry Night. Guess what? Bonnie said to her toys one afternoon. We're doing something special tonight. The toys were arranged on top of Bonnie's bed. They couldn't wait to find out what the something special was. We're going on an adventure, Bonnie said, clapping her hands. Though they didn't make a peep, the toys all wondered what kind of adventure was in store. We're ready to go, said Bonnie, as she gathered her toys in a big tote bag. First, she picked up the toys her new friend Andy had given her, Woody the Cowboy, Buzz Lightyear, Slinky Dog, and all their pals. Next, she collected her beloved old toys, Buttercup the Unicorn, Trixie the Triceratops, a hedgehog called Mr. Pricklepants, and a rag doll named Dolly. We're going to have so much fun, Bonnie told them excitedly. When Bonnie ran off to find a flashlight, the toys came to life. I hope there won't be any scary animals, Rex the dinosaur whispered. Maybe we're going to explore the attic, Trixie guessed. Before the friends could finish guessing, Bonnie burst in with a big smile. We're camping out, she announced as she scooped up the bag with all her favorite toys. Moments later, they were in a tent in Bonnie's very own backyard. Here we are, Bonnie said as she pulled the toys out of her bag. Rex, you sit next to Trixie. Buttercup, Woody, and Buzz, you'll be next to my sleeping bag. How about a picnic? Bonnie suggested as she passed out toy plates and food. Just then, they heard Bonnie's mom from outside the tent. Dinner time, she called. Bonnie jumped up. I've got to go eat my dinner, she said, but I'll be back soon. Left alone in the tent, the toys began to explore. "This sure is comfortable," said Jessie, admiring Bonnie's puffy sleeping bag. "Yes, the accommodations are quite satisfactory," Mr. Pricklepants agreed. "Well, shine my spurs," Woody exclaimed, noticing an electric lantern on the ground. He turned it on, and a warm glow lit up the tent. "Gather around, guys," he called out. "Let's have a sing-along," Woody suggested. The cowboy began to sing Camp Town Races with his hat over his heart. Jessie soon joined in, and Bullseye stomped his hooves. And when the first song was over, everyone wanted to sing some more. After a few tunes, the toys decided to head outside to explore the backyard. Mr. Potato Head opened the tent flaps. "The coast is clear," he said, peering out into the dark. "Look, the stars are out," said Buttercup as soon as they got outside. Buzz smiled and pointed to a constellation. "That, my friend, is the Big Dipper. 7 stars that form a ladle shape," he told his pals. Mr. Potato Head looked up. "I just saw a shooting star," he cried. Ham looked up too. "I think that was a firefly," he replied. "I'm gonna explore the yard," Jessie shouted, hopping on Bullseye's back. "Who wants to play freeze tag?" Trixie asked the other toys. But before they could even answer, she tapped Rex with her horn. "Tag, you're frozen," she called. The rest of the toys grinned and started to run as Trixie chased after them as fast as she could. "Hey," Rex called out, still frozen. "Somebody, tag me? Anybody?" Soon, the toys were tired and decided to go back into the tent. "How about a theatrical shadow puppet production?" suggested Mr. Pricklepants. "Great idea," said Woody. The toys used Bonnie's flashlight to make shadow puppets on the tent wall. First, Buzz made an airplane with his wings. Then, Mr. Pricklepants made an elephant by holding out his arm. Rex peeked outside the tent window. "Gee, it sure got dark fast," he said. But before he knew it, Dolly made a pair of bunny ears behind his head, and everyone laughed, even Rex. "Every sleepover needs a scary story," said Mr. Potato Head, clicking off the light. "Once, there was a little toy that got lost in the forest. The very dark forest," he began. Rex started to shiver. "Just like now," he said. "Suddenly, there were footsteps," Mr. Potato Head continued. Just then, the toys heard footsteps outside the tent. "Like now?" Jessie gasped. "A monster was coming," Mr. Potato Head went on. "Ah!" Rex shrieked as a huge shadow loomed over the tent. The toys flopped over and all went still. The tent flap opened wide. "I'm back!" It was Bonnie. She set the toys outside around the lantern. "It wouldn't be the best campout ever if we didn't toast marshmallows," she announced. The toys didn't say a word, but they couldn't have agreed more. And Rex was especially glad that there wasn't a real monster after all. The end.
Doc McStuffins, The Mermaid Dives In, by Sheila Sweeney Higginson, based on the episode by Kent Redeker, based on the series created by Chris Nee, illustrated by Character Building Studio and the Disney Storybook Artists. Finally, summer is here. Doc McStuffins can't wait to play in the park with her friends. Mom smooths sunscreen on Doc's skin. Now she's ready for some fun in the sun. "Is it okay if I take my toys and go play in the wading pool?" Doc asks. "Sure," says Mom. "I'll keep an eye on you." Doc wheels her wagon to the wading pool. Her stethoscope begins to glow. "Hi, guys," Doc says as her friends come to life. "I finally get to go swimming," Stuffy cheers. He jumps into the pool. Doc catches Stuffy in the nick of time. "You and Lammy can't go in the water," Doc laughs. "You're not water toys." But there is a water toy at the other side of the pool. She has long, flowing hair and a shimmering tail. "It's a mermaid," Lammy gasps. "They're like the princesses of the sea." Doc and Stuffy walk over to the other side of the pool. Then, Doc brings the mermaid to life with her magic stethoscope. "Hello, Dilly Scrumptious," the mermaid says. "My name is Melinda." "I'd love to watch you swim," Lammy says shyly. "Very well," Melinda says. "Prepare to be amazed." Doc takes a hoop out of the wagon and hands it to Surfer Girl. "Take this to the center of the pool so Melinda can jump through it." "Here I go," Melinda calls. "It will be the most amazing water leap you've ever seen." Melinda splashes into the pool, but then she disappears. "Hey, like, where'd she go?" asks Surfer Girl. "I see her," Bronte calls. "She's at the bottom of the pool." Doc reaches into the pool and rescues Melinda. "Did you mean to do that?" Doc asks her. "No," Melinda says. "I don't know why I sank to the bottom." "I don't know either," says Doc. "I'm worried something might be wrong with you." "Wrong? I don't think so," says Melinda. "Mermaids are perfect." "No one is perfect," Doc explains. "I think I should give you a checkup." First, Doc checks Melinda's heart with her stethoscope. "Your heartbeat sounds just as pretty as you are," says Doc. Then she listens to Melinda's lungs. "Your lungs sound good too," Doc adds. "Now I'm going to check your tail," Doc says. She asks Melinda to push with her tail. Melinda tries, but she can't do it. "Is something wrong with me?" she asks. Doc shrugs. "Has anyone ever wound up your winder-upper?" "I didn't even know I had one," Melinda says. "Aha! Doc McStuffins has a diagnosis. You have a case of stuck winder-upperitis," she tells Melinda. "Is that serious?" Melinda asks. Doc shakes her head. "I can fix it right up." She works on Melinda's winder-upper until it's unstuck. "Got it," Doc says. Then Lammy winds the winder and Melinda's tail starts to flap. "My tail is flapping," Melinda cheers. "Get ready for a wonderful mermaid leaping show." Melinda splashes into the pool, but she sinks again. "Oh dear," she cries. "I'm going down." Doc reaches into the pool and rescues Melinda again. "Oh, Doc," Melinda cries. "I'm a mermaid. I should be able to swim and leap and do all sorts of tricks. But I just keep sinking." "Did you have this problem when you took swimming lessons?" Doc asks. "What's that?" Melinda wonders. "That's when someone teaches you how to swim. You took them, right?" "No," Melinda says. "Do I need swimming lessons?" "Everyone should take swimming lessons," Doc explains. "I had so much fun learning to swim." Melinda is excited and wants to take swimming lessons too. "Let me handle this one," says Surfer Girl. "I used to be a lifeguard, so I gave swimming lessons all the time." First, Surfer Girl shows Melinda how to stroke with her arms. "That's it," says Surfer Girl. Then she shows Melinda how to kick with her tail. "Great job," Surfer Girl says. Soon, Melinda starts to swim on her own. "You're an amazing swimmer," Lammy calls. "I'm so glad I took swimming lessons," Melinda says. "I finally feel like a real mermaid." This time, when Melinda the mermaid leaps through the hoop, She swims like a real mermaid, too.